In tonight's Omnibus USA, a visit to a beautiful part of America, south from New York, across the Mason-Dixon line, and into the beautiful lands of North Carolina, and the world of country music, where we're going to meet Doc Watson, who's a star in this world, a singer and a virtuoso guitar player. With the Omnibus film crew went the folk song scholar A.L. Lloyd, Bert Lloyd, a longtime admirer of Doc Watson's. They spent a long weekend, first at a concert, later at Doc's home, deep in the Blue Ridge Mountains.
North Carolina, Saturday, April the 3rd, 1976.
Country weather, clear tonight, mostly sunny on Sunday, fair Sunday night and Monday. Tonight's low, a warm 41, tomorrow a pleasant 75, and chances of rain near zero tonight, 10% tomorrow. Humidity is 27% in Charlotte, barometer 30.01 and falling, wind southwest, about 8 miles an hour.
Easy Ed, 2D's Robinson of the Top Dog, keeping Charlotte Country 24 hours a day, all day. 1480 Radio. Little David.
Give me that good night special.
The town of Charlotte. The air's full of music, country music, born of the interaction of American folk song and commercial popular song, made into standard packages by the entertainment industry. It's the spiritual nourishment of millions of rural whites. Radio stations pump it out day and night. There's an endless stream of festivals in 10,000-seater coliseums. The stars of country music here outshine all other heroes. Let's meet one.
That's right, we're gonna miss the music.
Now would you make welcome from Deep Gap, North Carolina, stars of the United Artists label, Doc and Merle Watson.
If you shout, I won't pick. I mean that thing. Now, could I have your attention, please? We appreciate the enthusiasm, friend, but if you yell, the other man next to you can't hear. All right, oh, okay. Mama don't want no music played around here. Mama don't want no music played around here. We don't care what mama wants to hear, just let it get in the house. Don't let that music played around here. Mama don't want no harmonica played in here. Mama don't want no harmonica played around here. I don't care what your mama wants to hear, little harmonica in here. Don't like a harmonica played in here.
Sometimes I don't care what you're on, like, I saw that fiddle bow in the house. Don't like that fiddle played in here. Fiddle that thing, huh?
Sunday, April the 4th. The festival's over. We're traveling 100 miles into the hills towards Doc Watson's home. He's a blind musician whose head is full of some of the oldest American music and some of the newest. There's hardly another entertainer who can convince his audience with the whole range of southern white rural music, from the up-tempo stuff of Nashville to the lonely-sounding folk song of the mountains. At the little Appalachian settlement of Deep Gap, Doc's home. He was born into a community of hill farmers, banjo pickers, folk fiddlers, traditional singers. People poor in possessions, but rich in music.
The reason for my getting into music, the basic reason was that if there was any chance that I could earn a living for my family and do it with my own two hands, you know how a fella feels about a thing like that, it's a little pride involved, I wanted to do it. And I loved the music, and since it was something that I loved to do, I'd get into it. Well, I'd never had the thrill, except for a few local home folks when I was learning to play the old-time tunes in my young days. I'd never had the thrill of sitting down and playing to a listening audience, for real, you know, except at Fiddler's Convention. You always got a few fellas there that are, have a few shots of moonshine or whatever, you know, and they get a little noisy, but when I went to the campuses and started to play for folks and you could hear a pin drop, it was a little scary. The first concert I did scared me to death. It really did. But the most rewarding thing of my life was to do a song that I loved dearly, that was dear to my heart, as they say, and find that people were actually sometimes in tears from the emotions from the good old ballads and songs.
A local favorite is the song called The Cuckoo. It flew across the Atlantic from England, but words and tune got changed a bit in the mountains.
Gonna build me a log cabin on a mountain so high so I can see Willie as she goes walking by. Oh, the cuckoo, she's a pretty bird, Lord, she warbles as she flies. She'll never
Doc's regular musical partner is his son Merle, named after Merle Travis, the country musician who wrote 16 Tons.
Well, I've played cards in old England, and I've gambled over in Spain, and I'll bet you $10 that I'll beat you next game.
Doc Watson was born in 1923, just as a vast market was opening up for country music through local radio broadcasts and records specially produced for small-town drugstore sale. His family were strong hymn singers, fiddlers, banjo pickers. His elder brother Arnold plays banjo. His father-in-law, Gaither Carlton, was a sweet country fiddler. In off-work hours, there was always music in the kitchen or on the porch. Doc turned modest professional at the age of 30, played in country rock bands, and eventually he teamed up with a famous old-timer, Clarence Ashley.
We worked the local dance halls and clubs in this area and, you know, East Tennessee and Western North Carolina.
Mm-hmm.
But I never did any TV shows or any records. But it put a few biscuits on the table, as the old saying goes.
Yeah, sure.
A couple of pairs of jeans on the little fellas as they were growing up, so it was work. And then I enjoyed some of the music, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the truth of my life, musically speaking, was when the revival of the old-time music came along. I had a whole new interest aroused again because, to me, the old-time fiddling, the old-time ballads, there has never been anything prettier or ever will be.
When Doc was 7, his father made him a little banjo, and the first tune he taught him was this one, The Rambling Hobo. Monday, April the 5th.
Doc was born about 1 mile right round on the fur end of this mountain here, down on that, on the south side there, and I was too. I stayed there. I was born just a few hundred yards down below where Doc was born, and I stayed there when I was 14 years old. I thought I was a man, but I left. Went to a logging job over here by the name of White and Lumber Company.
Willard Watson is Doc's cousin, a man in his 70s, carpenter, toy maker, banjo picker, moonshiner. As they say, sharp as a whittling knife and tougher than hickory.
Well, Bert, my first memories of music was the little harmonica. You know, not the chromatic, just the little ones. I used to get one every year at Christmas, and occasionally, if I was pretty good and young, and I'd get one somewhere about halfway through the year, maybe a little past my birthday down there somewhere. And I guess to play a little straight country harmonica music was like whistling. It just became a natural part of me. I guess I was 6 or 7 when we got our first, we called it a graphophone, little table model Victrola, the old country records. But I was just thinking about the music in me. I remember I must have worried Mama a lot. Everything that had a musical tone, if it was a pot or a cowbell or whatever, I was always tapping on it to see what it sounded like around the house. And actually, my first stringed instrument was a little homemade banjo that Dad made for me, and he put a catskin head on it.
Yeah, well, remember that. We'd have to keep it head part of the time. You were so noisy with it.
Yeah, I know. You know,
we just had to sneak around and get it and hide it. Or you couldn't find it.
Well, sometimes I guess I worried her to death, especially when she'd have little headaches around
the house. We couldn't hardly get away from it, but sometimes we'd hide it, see a little fish, you know.
My first actual memories of music, when I think about it, is sitting on Mama's lap when I was a little, just a little fella, maybe 2 years old, and hearing the singing in the church. And it was a great sound. The singing was very pure then. no vibrato in the voices at all, you know, just good straight harmonies. And some of those mountain people had voices like you wouldn't believe.
Did they sing their hymns out of books?
Yes, they did, and my wife's grandfather, Reverend Thomas Robbins, was a good singer, and he taught old-time singing schools at the church. He'd have maybe 3 or 4 days along in the fall, usually after the crops were laid by before time to harvest. They'd have a what they call singing school, and he taught them the shape notes and the sound of the notes, you know, so that they could learn to sing the songs out of the old Christian harmony and the old hymn books that came along right after the Christian harmony type songs.
In pioneer days, traveling singing masters visited the settlements to teach the rudiments of music. For quick learning, they used a patent notation called fa sol la, or shape notes. Mostly, they taught hymns in 3 or 4 parts. And the old shape note hymn books, such as Southern Harmony and Sacred Harp, are still used in the South. In the upland South, local folk ways, folk religion, folk culture emerged earlier and developed longer than anywhere else in the States. Industry and urban ways came late, and the shock was all the greater. The poor and vulnerable Appalachian communities have taken most of the hard knocks of the American economy. Still, Doc's Corner of the Mountains did better than most.
We raised everything that we went upon with coffee and sugar. We hardly ever was able to buy a sack of flour, I don't think. Not very often. Maybe we had biscuit for breakfast, but it's cornbread too.
We were actually lived good compared to a lot of the folks in the cities during the Depression. And I don't know if we didn't appreciate music a little more, maybe, than a lot of folks that had all the other troubles, because knowing where that next meal was going to come from made a lot of difference when I was growing up. I never worried about nothing like that. When I came to this country in 1845, then I thought myself lucky for to be alive. I looked all around me, but none could I see that were sweeter or fairer, pretty Sarah, than thee. Pretty Sarah, pretty Sarah, likewise my mother too. I have started for to ramble this country all through, and when I get lonesome, I'll sit down and weep, and I'll think of my pretty Sarah wherever I sleep. Oh, if I was a poet and could write a fine hand, I would write my love a letter that she'd long understand. I would send it by the waters where the islands overflow. I remember my pretty Sarah wherever I go.
Traditionally, the mountain economy depends on subsistence farming, logging, and handcraft. It's a culture of hard scrabble and little gain. The family is the economic unit, and children are economically profitable. A problem there for the boy blind from babyhood. problem Doc's father had to overcome.
One morning at breakfast, it was in the spring, I guess I was 14 then, and he leant back and took a big sip out of his coffee cup and said, "Son, do you think you can learn to pull a cross-cut saw like the rest of these boys?" And I said, "Yeah." It's kind of sound like a man where it was or not, you know. And he had a new ground piece that he'd already fell all the trees on. And he said, "We'll cut up them trees, and you can help me cut off a couple of big cuts that I can roll out in the pile." And he said, "Then you can rest while I trim a few limbs off." And I'll tell you, Bert, that first day after pulling that crosscut saw, this boy was ready to go to sleep. It made every muscle in my body sore. I don't know if you've ever done that or not, but it requires just about every muscle in your body to do it, and it's like swimming. But once you get the knack of it, it doesn't hurt you anymore. And, you know, that one thing, Emma putting me to work, realizing that I was worth something, might have been the thing that gave me the nerve to tackle music as a profession and get out there and face the world. No offense meant to the school that I went to, but they didn't understand blind people then, and they made you feel like a misfit in society. It was out of ignorance, of course. Some of it was. I'll leave it at that right there. But if I'd gone on to that school or been left feeling like that by my parents, I wouldn't have been worth the salt in my bread. And I'm really proud of my father for that thing.
In isolated communities, local legend counts for much. Local names feature in the songs. The events of the Tom Dooley murder happened only a few miles away a century ago. Its events stick in the folk memory like a burr.
Hang your head, Tom Dooley, hang your head and cry. You killed little Ari Foster and you know you're bound to die. You took her on the hillside for to make her your wife. You took her on the hillside and there you took her life. Hang it, Tom Dooley, hang your head and cry. You killed little Ari Foster and you know you're bound to die.
Well, it's Tom Dooley and Laurie Foster and Ann Melton was three. I don't know too much about it. It's been so long ago I've heard my father and my grandmother talk about it, but I don't hardly remember what they told about it. I think this year Ann Melton was his girlfriend before he went to the war, and then she got married while he was in the war, but she still wanted him when she come back, and he had Laurie Foster for his girlfriend, and they was engaged to be married, and they slipped off to get married is when they killed her, they said. They said it was Ann Melton that killed Laurie.
My great-grandmother told Daddy, you know, about the same thing. And I did remember hearing that it wasn't him that killed her, that it was Ann Melton that killed her. And that she told my great-grandmother when she was sick that if she knew she'd never get well, that there was something that she would tell them all, but if she got well, it would never do, that she couldn't let it out. So everybody thought that she was going to tell that, you know, that she done the murder.
In Tennessee, you can take down my old violin and play it all you please. For at this time tomorrow, boys, it'll be of no use to me. Hang your head, Tom Dooley, hang your head and cry. You kill little Laurie Foster and you know you're bound to die. At this time tomorrow, reckon where I'll be. Way down yonder in the holler, hanging from a wild oak tree. Hang your head, Tom Dooley, hang your head and cry. You kill little Laurie Foster and you know you're bound to die.
The South is altering. Industry, airports, freeways, electronics mean deep change. While accepting all that, the mountain people still hang on to some of the old values. Stern evangelical religion, love of hunting, homemade music and dancing. Willard Watson used to be a champion step dancer, and he can still outlast Doc's young daughter, Nancy.
I stand on the corner with a low-down blues, great big hole in the bottom of my shoe. Honey, let me be your salty dog. I said, if I can't be your salty dog, well, I ain't gonna be a little man at all. Honey, let me be your salty dog. I'm standing on the corner with my hat in my hand, waiting for the woman that ain't got no man. Honey, let me be your salty dog. Yeah, if I can't be your salty dog, I ain't gonna be a little man at all. Honey, let me be your salty dog. Broke my liquor jug all to pieces. Honey, let me be your salty dog. Well, if I can't be your salty dog, I ain't gonna be a little man at all. Honey, let me be your salty dog. The worst kid ever was in my life, my buddy like caught me kissing his wife. Honey, let me be your salty dog. And if I can't be your salty dog, I ain't gonna be a little man at all. Honey, let me be your salty dog.
I went to school, the state school for the blind over in Raleigh, North Carolina. I didn't even go to high school. I guess I was, they didn't start me to school till I was 10 years old. And I guess I got a little too restless to stay in school. And I didn't quit with my education. I tried to read and learn a few other things about the world and about what there is to learn, you know, out of books after I quit going to school. I must, between that and the time I married, I must have read 200 or 300 books. And I read a lot after that until I got into the music as a profession in the early 60s. And that put the squash on my reading. I don't get to read much. When I'm home, I don't want to. I like to kind of visit and loaf around a little in the grocery when I'm home.
Shady Grove, my little love, Shady Grove, I say. Shady Grove, my little love, I'm bound to go away. Cheeks as red as a blooming rose and eyes are the prettiest brown. She's the darling of my heart, the sweetest little girl in town. Wish I had a glass of wine and bread and meat for two. I'd set it down on a golden plate and give it all to you. Shady Grove, my little love, Shady Grove, I say. Shady Grove, my little love.
Doc had the song Shady Grove from his dad. It reminds him of going to visit his wife Rosa Lee when he was a boy. He said, Shady Grove to me means happiness.
I wish I had me a big fine horse and the corn to feed him on. A little Shady Grove to stay at home and feed him while I'm gone. When I went to see my Shady Grove, she's standing in the door. Her shoes and stockings in her hand and her little bare feet on the floor. Shady Grove, my little love, Shady Grove, I say. Shady Grove, my little love, I'm about to go away. Now when I was a little boy, I wanted a Barlow knife. And now won't little Shady Grove to say she'll be my wife. A kiss from pretty little Shady Grove as sweet as brandy wine. And there ain't no girl in this whole world that's prettier than mine. Oh, Shady Grove.
grow, I say, shady grow, my little town to go away.
Doc says he sometimes feels his memory goes back further than his own lifetime, to log rollings and corn shuckings when there wasn't so much hustle, and people had time to think about each other as neighbors and friends. Now, as a professional musician, he's in a world of telephones and agents and concert tours and recording contracts, and wild audiences that pressurize him to play loud, fast, and full of tension. He tries to give them as much folk music as possible, in the hope of stabilizing them a bit. He says, it sure helps to stabilize me.
And am I born to die? To lay this body down? And must my trembling spirit fly into a world unknown? And must my trembling spirit fly into a world unknown? Soon as from earth I go, what will become of me? Eternal happiness or woe? Must then my portion be eternal happiness or woe? Must then my portion be?
Doc Watson was singing an old Wesleyan hymn. And the photographs, by the way, used in the film were taken back in the hungry 30s by Doris Ullman and by the painter Ben Sharp.